Good afternoon. The hearing on Spain's leadership of the OSCE will please come to order. And I want to say at the outset, Mr. Minister, how much we appreciate your being here today. And it's a very interesting time, of course, as you prepare to host the ministerial meeting next month in Madrid. I'm sorry that our chairman, Mr. Hastings, is not here, but his plane was canceled this morning. Those of us who exist on airplanes know the chance we take in trying to do that and to get to where we need to go on time. But as a longstanding member of the commission, I'm certainly pleased to welcome you on behalf of my colleagues. Certainly, we are unique in our focus on developments in the OSCE from the parliamentary perspective. I appreciate your prepared remarks that recognize distinctive contributions to parliamentarians to the Helsinki process. My personal involvement in that aspect of OSCE dates back to 1993, when Finland hosted the annual session of the OSCE Parliamentary Assembly. And over the years, I have appreciated the opportunity to work closely with the fellow parliamentarians from throughout the region, from Vancouver to Vladivostok, The OSCE has provided important leadership on issues from human trafficking and combating anti-Semitism and other forms of intolerance to promoting projects aimed at protecting the environment and advancing security among the participating states, now numbering 56. Gender equality, as you point out, must be a priority, an issue I have pressed in the context of the Parliamentary Assembly, along with Tony Nagard of Sweden, the Special Representative on Gender Issues. And I also noted your reference to Afghanistan, the OSCE's newest partner for cooperation. Last week, I had the privilege of meeting with President Karzai in London and talked again about the movement of women and the benefits that he would have from educating his young girls. When I first flagged the concerns regarding developments in Afghanistan, some people said that isn't our concern. It's outside the OSCE region. Well, one of the lessons of September 11th is that events in seemingly faraway lands do matter for the people there and for ultimately our own security. Mr. Minister, I know you have an ambitious agenda for the Madrid meeting, and the Russians and others may complicate your work given the OSCE rule requiring consensus. Thank you for being here to update us on these and other developments in the OSCE arena, and we will be pleased to hear from you.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. Let me first start by conveying to my good friend, Congressman Hastings, for not being here, but convey to him my friendship and recognition. And at the same time, thank you for this opportunity to speak before the United States Helsinki Commission. I know that the Helsinki Commission plays a unique role as a forum for debate on the burning issue of the day facing the OSCE and the region. In so doing, this commission paid unique tribute to the long-standing and continuing engagement by the United States with the OSCE and the values that underpin it. The OSCE can only work with the full engagement of the participating state, the government, the parliament, and their societies. The United States, of course, has a special role to play. For that, this is an excellent moment to share with you some of the priorities and activities of the OSCE under the Spanish presidency as we approach the Ministerial Council in Madrid at the end of November. Let me start by saying that the Spanish chairmanship and the OSCE have been very supporting effort to find a just and lasting formula that will contribute to the stability of the Balkans. We have managed over the years to maintain a neutral and unbiased position in what regards the status of Kosovo, and all communities recognize this effort of OSCE. While the OSCE is not directly involved in the status negotiation, we are, as OSCE, contributing to the process of creating the necessary condition on the ground for the implementation of the status settlement. We are ready to stay in Kosovo in order to focus on monitoring protection of rights of communities, particularly regarding the centralization and the protection of cultural and religious sites. On Afghanistan, as you refer to that, the situation in Afghanistan continues to have a substantial impact on security in Central Asia. In this respect, the OSCE is considering a series of border management projects, particularly in Tajikistan. We hope to encourage counterparts in Afghanistan in these border-related activities. Even more, we are proposing to have informal discussion at ministerial level at the lunch that we have in Madrid to address the issue of how OSCE can be useful for the stability and the future of Afghanistan. On Kazakhstan, as you know well, Kazakhstan has announced its aim to chair the OSCE. This bid has been welcomed by all members of the organization, and we hope and we are sure that it's an excellent opportunity to Kazakhstan, to Central Asia, and the OSCE as a whole. For now, there is not a final consensus regarding the date, only the date, of the chairmanship by Kazakhstan. But as chairman in office, Spain is actively seeking to build a consensus, announce all our OSCE states on this important decision for the organization. On Georgia, in recent months, we have witnessed serious incidents both in Abkhazia, in the zone of the Georgian-Ossetian conflict. These incidents are cause for concern and stress the need for further efforts in promoting trust and cooperation. In relation to the missile incident on the 6th of August, the Spanish chairmanship has adopted a forward-looking approach and put forward proposals for concrete preventive measures to avoid similar incidents in the future, which constitute a priority for the Spanish chairmanship. On Moldova, the OSCE continues to work to facilitate a settlement on the Transnistrian issue in Moldova through participation in the FAS+2 format of negotiation, along with the mediators from the Russian Federation in Ukraine and the observers from the United States and European Union. We have tried throughout our chairmanship to convince the sides to return to negotiation, as we share the convention with other OSCE states that negotiation in this format are the appropriate means to achieve a sustainable and lasting settlement, one that will give Moldova an excellent chance to develop and prosper. On Nagorno-Karabakh, regarding the Nagorno-Karabakh conflict, the continued mediation effort throughout the year by the co-chairs and the OSCE Minsk group, with the active support of my personal representative, have not resulted in a breakthrough in the settlement process. Nevertheless, the parties remain committed to continue the negotiation. Let me address now the CFE, Treaty of Conventional Armed Forces in Europe. The Spanish OSCE chairmanship notes with deep concern the uncertainties concerning the continued implementation of the Treaty of Conventional Armed Forces in Europe, CFEE. We cannot afford to put at risk the hard-won gains in this field. The OSCE chairmanship calls on the parties to renew their effort to display the necessary flexibility toward resolving outstanding treaty-related issues in a spirit of openness, transparency, and mutual cooperation. The Ministerial Council in Madrid will be an opportunity to move the process forward. On terrorism, the Spanish chairmanship has placed anti-terrorism as a top priority on the OSCE agenda and has therefore organized four major conferences, and a set of decisions are to be adopted at Madrid ministerial meeting. On economic and environmental dimension, the second basket of OSCE, we have promoted a full-fledged discussion with a particular focus on the problems of land degradation and water management. The OSCE can act as a platform for dialogue and a network for cooperation on environmental security. Given the OSCE comprehensive concept of security, it is only natural the OSCE develop a profile on a question of such vital importance to all of us. On human dimension, Spain has also placed the challenge of integrating diversity in pluralistic societies high on the OSCE agenda. This issue is one that goes to the heart of our pledge to build democratic states and societies. Diversity is today a fact for all of our society. The challenge we face is to ensure a strong participation by all individuals in our societies and within our democracy. In this respect, UN Alliance of Civilization is a useful instrument to address diversity in different areas such as youth, education, media, or migration. The OSCE Chairmanship Conference on Intolerance and Discrimination Against Muslims, held in Cordoba in 9 and 10th of October, was a major initiative for our chairmanship and reflected our conviction that tolerance and no discrimination should stand at the top national international priorities. I will add this conference followed the OSCE Conference on Antisemitism, another form of intolerance held in 2005, also in Cordoba, as well the Bucharest Ministerial Meeting on Tolerance and No Discrimination held early this year. Promotion of gender equality and freedom of the media and fight against trafficking in human beings had been among our priorities. A long list of activities and seminars testify of it. Let me address the election observation and the role of OOD. Over the years, the Office of Democratic Institution and Human Rights, ODIHR, has earned an international reputation for its leadership, professionalism, and excellence in the critical area of elections observation. The ODIHR mission is much broader and encompassing a wide range of democratization activities aimed at closing the gap between the commitments on paper and the reality on the ground and the participating state. ODIHR role is fundamental in OSCE. We have consistently supported its activity throughout our chairmanship. All OSCE countries have made commitments to democratic election and supporting a process that leads to democratic governments, including those related to international observation of election. We have paid close attention to electoral observation during the Spanish chairmanship. In this respect, as the election to the Duma are approaching, we are still waiting for a Russian invitation to ODIHR to observe them in a way which will allow us to maintain our common high standard on election observation. If there is a danger in the debate of election observation, it is that some participation extent would like to shift the discourse away from commitment and the fulfillment of lack of fulfillment. We find it unhelpful to call into question the well-established OSCE practice on election observation, which so far has proved most fruitful. In this respect, it is our concern the announcement made by the Russian representative in Vienna indicating that the invitation to observe Duma election will be a la carte. Let me address the role of parliamentary assembly in this process. I'm very pleased that President Lemarker testified before the Helsinki Commission on 18 October 2007. As a member of parliament myself, I can only stress that the political expertise of parliamentarians, along with the responsibility incumbent on elected officials for ensuring transparency, accountability, and public confidence, provide a rich experience to complement the broad range of electoral expertise represented in election observation activities such as that undertaken by the ODIHR. I'm pleased to say that the OSCE chairmanship, together with the leadership of the Parliamentary Assembly, has ensured the constructive nature of the debate on electoral issues, without trying to change the fundamental nature of the OSCE as an intergovernmental organization, of that of the ODIHR as the key institution mandated with election observation. The OSCE chairmanship has invested efforts to establish a good cooperation, which has produced a solid record in the OSCE region. We should seek to maintain this at all costs. It is vital for the values to which we have subscribed. It is vital also as the flagship activity of the organization. The relationship between the ODIHR and the Parliamentary Assembly must necessarily be of a special nature. It's a relationship of partnership and respect for each other's contribution, not of competition. Let me address now the Partners for Cooperation and the Mediterranean Partners. Enhancing the relationship of the OSCE with Partners for Cooperation has been as well as the top of the Spanish chairmanship agenda. Setting a partnership fund has been one of the main goals within the contact group. We are confident that the remaining difficulties will be overcome, allowing the OSCE participation in projects with the partners. Difficulties have also encountered to convene this year seminar with Mediterranean partners. We think that holding this seminar in Israel for the first time should provide a unique opportunity for a new impetus in our work with the Mediterranean. We consider our chairmanship initiatives, such as the Corva Conference last October, have contributed to attract the interest of the partner OSCE activities. In this light, there is no need to recall that the Mediterranean continues to be a relevant chapter of OSCE work and important of its contribution to security of the OSCE area. Let me finalize addressing the Ministerial Council and the perspective of the Madrid Ministerial Meeting. The OSCE to-do list is expanding. It is only natural that our agenda for the OSCE Ministerial Council in Madrid at the end of this month is ambitious. Over the remaining time, the Spanish chairmanship will be seeking actively to garner consensus on vital decisions, including future chairmanships, the role of OSCE in environmental security, convention on legal personality of OSCE, strengthening pluralistic societies, deepening cooperation in counterterrorism, and the fight against trafficking of human beings. Protracted conflict will be on the ministerial agenda as well as OSCE mission on the field. It is clear that the ambitious goal that the participation state have set collectively for the OSCE must be matched by the adequate resources. I must be frank here, insisting on reducing resources while increasing mandate doesn't service the values that rightly underpin the OSCE. There is nothing quite like the OSCE, neither a military alliance nor an economic union. This organization brings together on a permanent basis 56 countries, as you mentioned, Chairperson, from Vancouver to Vladivostok, around this shared vision. This vision was born in Helsinki. It was strengthened in Paris and Istanbul. Certainly, the work of the United States Helsinki Commission, it has a vital part of the pursuit of this vision. I thank you for the support and dedication for this goal. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We appreciate that report. Obviously, the meeting in Madrid is critical to the survival of OSCE. And I wanted to ask you some questions about that. As you know, the Russian official in charge of the elections of the Duma announced today that he would allow 400 outside observers. Since OSCE had more than 400 at the last election, and given the fact that Russia has made statements along with, I believe, Belarus, Kazakhstan, and several others, that they think we spend too much time on elections and human rights, I'd love to have your assessment of that, particularly since they want reform. And I think there might be some pitfalls ahead with OSCE if we were to go ahead with that.
Well, I think our role as observation process in all the 56 member OSCE have to be, you know, serious, have to be credible, have to be, you know, effective. And that has been the responsibility of the chairmanship of Spain in the OSCE. We have had a good experience in all the electoral processes from Albania, what we started with a very difficult situation on local elections, through what has been the last Ukraine election, that all of them has gone through a very well, I would say, performance of the ODIHR and Parliamentary Assembly work. We have some misunderstanding of Parliamentary Assembly ODIHR in Serbia, even if the elections were quite positive, And after that, we have been very much involved in order to get a successful outcome of the electoral processes. Of course, Russian Federation elections are extremely important, and we've been in close contact with the Russian authorities in order that we can play and assume our responsibility. I can assure you that we will continue to give to the Russian authorities, you know, the sense that for the good responsibility and credibility and legitimacy of the result of the election, we need that OSCE will be involved through the Parliamentary Assembly, through ODIHR, and we are in close contact with the Russian authorities to get, you know, positive and effective, you know, involvement in order to have a fair and free election in Russia.
That's certainly what we strive for. At the conclusion of the Belgian chairmanship last year, your predecessor spoke of holding this organization together, a notion I think held by others, perhaps including the Finns, who will succeed you in January. Is this the low point for OSCE, and what do you attribute that to?
Well, Madam Chair, I think the organization paradoxically is facing the most exciting and challenging time after many years of being a quite established organization that there was no great debate, no great, polemics. But at this stage, when we are starting the new century, I think all countries and this family spirit of the OSCE, you know, understand that we are in a situation that is the only organization where not only Europeans, United States, what we call the West world, but also the newcomers of the Caucasus and Central Asia share the same principle and the same values and same objective. In this new situation, I think is the only fora where, you know, in a sense of responsibility, there is some divergent point of view. And what we have is to really enhance this esprit of famille that have to be, you know, put into force in the next future. My intention, as I inform the member state, is that I would like to start to reflect of the need for a future summit of OSCE. It's a long time since, the head of state and government has not met together. And of course, we are very proud to be foreign minister and myself. We are very strong personalities and we can solve many issues. But when, we are at the crossroad of the future of the organization, it is high time after Istanbul, I think 11 years, no? 10 years, more or less 10 years. It's high time for the head of state and governments to gather together and to think if this organization is useful for security and cooperation for the whole region of Vancouver to Vladivostok. It's a quite, challenging task, and I think in this world we need sometimes the head of state and government to really reflect the challenge and the priorities in terms of security and cooperation. So I will try to get in my conclusion in ministerial meeting in Madrid of to give the parties and the member state the mandate to start to explore the possibility for this summit meeting.
Do you think that some of the member states are threatened by the fact of that we push for pluralistic democracies? Is that a serious problem or something we can deal with?
Well, democracy, everybody adhere to. Democracy is a permanent, exercise. Of course, we have a long-standing member state with very strong sound and roots on democracy, institution building, rule of law. But there has been many countries that are now full member of OSCE that are coming from authoritarian regimes with a very difficult, economic and social structure that are, of course, are aiming and working for consolidating their democratization processes. So I can assure you that in my trips and my tour to some of these countries, mainly on Central Asia, I found in all of them this eagerness for consolidating the democratic processes, but also with the sense of a tremendous challenge in terms of lack of democratic culture. There has not been a political party, there has not been freedom of expression, freedom of speech. Doesn't mean that they have not to, fulfill the all criteria and principle of respect of human rights and all kind of engagement and principle that the OSCE can provide them. But also they are very much satisfied with the project and programs that OSCE can provide to all of them. For me, it was a great experience for, Spain being full member of Helsinki process from 1975. If you were asked to any public Spanish people to say about OSCE, nobody understand what is this organization. I have difficulty with my media, to say that it's important to
I
be
think
the,
we
chairman,
have the same thing.
The chairman in office of OSCE. So the paradox is when you go to Turkmenistan or to Uzbekistan or to Azerbaijan, you are the king. The chairman in office of OSCE is more important than the head of state of, and so they are very much committed, very much hopeful that they can be supported by this organization in terms of institution building, of some how you can promote women, gender in the institution, the NGOs, this civil society that is taking shape. So the role of OSCE is tremendous. But sometimes we, as Westerners, we are too much, demanding. You have to do B, C, D in 24 hours. 24 hours for this society is not so easy. So I think we should try to get them involved, to get part of this new West that we can call it for the defending of democracy and human rights and all the our legacy of the Western world, but at the same time understanding the challenge that they have a tremendous economic and social difficulties that they have to get something back. For that reason, the Spanish presidency is very much in favor of giving Kazakhstan the chairmanship of the OSCE, because that will, for the first time, it will not be either European Union member state, the chairman, that for the first time we will have the sense of partnership that all member states are member states that can have responsibility to lead the organization. So that is a tremendous challenge we have to face together, and I'm hopeful that we all together we will succeed to get a positive answer to Kazakhstan's request to have the presidency of the OSCE.
Well, I want to thank you for your chairmanship, and you've had some critical issues. I, too, have been very proud of my own membership in OSCE, and we did wonderful work during the Cold War, I think, and I'm very grateful for the opportunity. And as you say, hardly anyone, except those of us who are members, know what good work has been done. But one thing, I know you mentioned this in your statement, the August 6th missile incident between Russia and Georgia. We had an OSCE border monitoring system there till a couple of years ago. Do you feel that would have happened had it still been there? And should it be reinstituted?
Well, when the incident took place, immediately we moved forward to get both sides. First, to investigate and to try to have an objective analysis and of what has happened. And then, secondly, to appoint a special representative of myself in order to produce a kind of confidence building between Russians and Georgians. I visited Russia, I went to Moscow, and the day after I went to Georgia. And I can assure you that both sides, I think after our talks and discussion, they are much more concerned and much more convinced that they have to look for the future, as you say, to avoid new incidents. So I think the role of OSCE is to create the atmosphere and the framework for confidence building measure. OSCE is the appropriate forum for, supporting. We have military observers in the region. We can have a reinforced observer on the borders. We can even think about some early warning system for the future. So, at the same time, encouraging the two sides to really engage in a serious discussion, because as I told both the Russian and the Georgian, they are neighbors, so neighbors have to live together, have to respect together, have to respect each other. So they are going, borders are not going to disappear. So if they want to have security and stability and good relationship for the future, they have to understand each other. So I think with our action, we relax and we cool down the tension. Thanks God. We have still our representative in case it's needed to maintain contacts and discussion. And I hope that during the ministerial meeting in Madrid, we can overcome even to create a better atmosphere of the situation. I have to thank also the role of United States diplomacy in this issue. I know that State Department is extremely very much involved to create the condition for better understanding between Russia and Georgia. And I think altogether, with our modest contribution, we can really facilitate a better relationship between Georgia and Russia.
That would be wonderful. If Kosovo unilaterally declared independence, how would that impact the ability of the OSCE to continue to function there, because its existing mandate is going to expire at the end of the year, and it will, to have it renewed, it has to be subject to consensus by all the states, including Russia and Serbia. What do you think the chances are for that?
Well, of course, as you know, we are not part of OSCE. We are not involved on the negotiation of final status of Kosovo. I mean, for the moment, we don't know. We should not prejudge what will go to be the final outcome of Kosovo, but of course we have to be prepared. OSCE is the larger organization deployed in Kosovo. It's the organization that really got to the roots of understanding and reconciliation and confidence-building measures, because we are in the different localities, municipalities, and we know our people are directly involved in the daily basis, on how to handle the whole security in the different areas and local municipalities in Kosovo. So it's very important that OSCE maintain its engagement in Kosovo, whatever is going to be the future status. We have said that, of course, we need a new mandate, as you mentioned, because at the end of the year, the mandate of our deployment in Kosovo will be over. We hope that the parties, we've been in close contact with Serbia and other actors in order to get their understanding that OSCE is an objective partner that is doing a positive work for all communities. And I hope that during ministerial meeting in Madrid, we can get some understanding of that in order that we can have a renovation of the mandate without any precondition of what is going to be the final status of Kosovo. Of course, if everything goes through a Security Council resolution of UN, it will be much easier. I noted on the draft of Security Council UN resolution, there was already a paragraph about the need for renewing the mandate of OSCE in Kosovo. But if there is no UN Security Council resolution, you should try to get it through other means. So we are aware of that, we are conscious of that, and we will work in order that our men in Kosovo, that, as I told you, is 1,100 people already deployed there, so it's even one of the most important international presence in Kosovo, can maintain their work and their contribution to the stability and prosperity of the people of the region.
Just one or two more questions, if I may. It's good to have you here.
I'm here. I'm very happy. So
I want to talk about Lebanon for a moment. I was privileged to travel to the Middle East with Speaker Pelosi in April. And of the five countries we visited, Lebanon was the saddest. The president at that time was afraid to leave the parliamentary building. Parliament itself had not met for some time. We were very concerned about Hezbollah. We were concerned about the insurgents crossing the Lebanese border, going after our soldiers in Iraq. Do you see any developments in that country that would lead it to be able to join the Mediterranean partners at any time in the future? Did you get some sense of hope?
I'm cautiously optimistic. I'm Lebanon. We made a trip with my colleague, the French foreign minister, Mr. Kushner, and the and the Italian foreign minister, Mr. D'Alema, and myself. And it was better than we expected. We found Lebanese political forces extremely eager to overcome this kind of fatalism. You know, Lebanon, as you mentioned, is a country that has so much suffered throughout history, and it has suffered through the conflict and I will say the interference of others, that they feel for once that they have to really try to overcome their differences among themselves and look for the future. Mm-hmm. In this sense, there has been a much more clear commitment of all political forces, mainly among the Christian community, because as you know, the next president have to be through Taif Accord, have to be a Maronite, a Christian, of the sense of historical responsibility. I'm feeling that they are moving forward. They are aware of the tremendous consequences that will have to suffer if there is no an agreement before the 25th of November. And for that reason, all parties are working in order to make some compromise, in order to get a candidate that can have the support of all political parties. I think as international community, we have only one responsibility at this stage, is to give them a sense of freedom to work among themselves and try to get an agreement among themselves, not to try to identify when one partner, one other. I think our message should to be encouragement, sense of responsibility, of course, support. and I hope that things has been developed are going to the right direction, and finally we can get a president of Lebanon that will get the consensus of all parties, including, of course, the main party is the majority now, is the 14th of March. That means the political parties that are now being the majority in the last elections. No? So I hope that all together they can get this this candidate to be the man of consensus, and then we'll follow for the stability and the better security of Lebanon.
Did you have any discussions with the ability to have the UN investigate the Hariri assassination?
Well, we have a discussion with, of course, with Nabil Berri and Saad Hariri himself. I met with all the principal leaders of Lebanon. You know, it's Spain. I'm talking now as Spanish foreign minister, and now OSCE, because OSCE has no any mandate on Lebanon. We are in favor of the tribunal, no? Personally, I was very close friend of Rafik Hariri. I have my personal experience with Rafik Hariri. 3 days before he was assassinated, I have a phone call with him, and I have been very much involved, no, defending his ideals and his principles. So I'm very much involved in what has happened, and what we need is to have a clarity and finally justice to be, you know, apply for this very outrageous assassination.
If Mr. Berri won't call the parliament together, they're pretty unlikely to ask for the tribunal. Did you discuss that with him at all? Because we did. And I have to tell you,
for the parliament,
made no impact on him.
For the
speaker.
Parliament?
Yes.
I didn't.
They've not met in some months.
Of course not. I mean, they are in a very difficult situation. I mean, Lebanon has been through a very tough situation. I met some of MPs that they are afraid of their life, and they are,
yes, they are,
know,
with good cause.
Living in a hotel, in Phoenicia Hotel. I went to pay tribute to their courage. I went to see them. And what we have is to overcome that. I mean, that they can live without any concern of their life and security. So we are working all to guarantee that. No? Lebanon is a very, very promising democracy in the Middle East, and we should work for that.
Oh, if I could stray again from not a OSCE member, but you know, Iran is a major concern for the United States and for the EU. How does Spain view that current situation? Do you see any common ground between the EU and the U.S. on Iran?
Well, you say this is not OSCE.
I saved the best one for last.
Can talk as a Spanish foreign minister about Iran, no?
I'd love to hear the Spanish perspective on Iran.
Yes, of course. it's a perspective that's very similar of the United States and others. You know, we are very much concerned about the situation in Iran and the situation of the lack of response of Security Council resolution of UN. You know, I have two words of our policy towards Iran. Number one is full implementation of Security Council resolution. Number two, three words I will say, full implementation of Security Council resolution. Number two, unity of international community to give this strong message to Iran. And third, dialogue, in the sense that we need to really explore and exhaust all dialogue in order that we can get some results. That is the way we are conducting our policy. We have been in close contact with the United States. You know, our high representative for common and foreign security policy, Dr. Javier Solana, is the one who has been in charge by not only European Union, but United mm-hmm. States, to engage with Iranian in order to find a diplomatic and political solution. We are supporting this mission, but we are not ruling out anything. If the mission doesn't produce result, we said that we are ready as European Union to study new measures against Iran, but let's first concentrate in the efforts of our envoy, our common envoy. Javier Solana is the envoy of United States, Russian Federation, and European Union, in order to get some results. The most important thing is that for the moment we have keep the unity of the main international actors. We are sending a very strong message to Iran to comply to Security Council resolution, and that's what we are trying to do.
I know you have a great influence on them, and I hope very much that that works. Are there any other comments you'd care to make before adjournment?
Well, no, only in terms of OSCE. I mentioned in my, I think was the last paragraph. I know that always when we are in the Congress, the next day we, Congress very influential on budget, no? Hmm?
Yes.
So we heard some rumors that there are some difficulties by the U.S. administration to reduce its contribution to OSCE. And what we are asking only you is to really be positive. I mean, if you want, as we all want, mm-hmm. a much more credible and efficient yeah. OSCE with larger mandate, because the situation now is not only to deal with electoral processes, but we are also taking care of Afghanistan, of Central Asia, of the Caucasus, on the environmental issue, on democracy, on unresolved conflicts. We know that what is a bureaucracy? We know that the bureaucracy always make some concern of U.S. Administration, but really we should also have the sense of responsibility and have, the financial support of mm-hmm. the United States.
Chairman Hastings and I absolutely agree with you. $12 billion a month for war of all borrowed money. I think we've neglected an awful lot of things. I was just at a conference in London a week ago, over the weekend, an international, a global conference on maternal mortality. The United States pulled out, would not sponsor it because they would not do a panel on abstinence only. And the speaker thought it was not a good thing for the United States of America to be absent. So she sent five of members of the House over so that we would be present. We're very much aware of that and want to meet our responsibility. I certainly appreciate your being here today, and I've learned a great deal and look forward to seeing you at the next OSCE meeting. I need to say the statements of Chairman Hastings, Co-Chair Cardin, Ranking Member Smith will be included in the record of this hearing. The unofficial transcript of today's hearing, as well as all of the statements, will be posted on the Commission's website, www.osce.gov. Thank you all very much, and the hearing is now adjourned.
Thank you.